Welcome back. We are in the Morrowind again. We are just picking back up where we left off in the ancestral tomb, doing a little tomb robbing. And I sold all of the loot, the very heavy weapons and equipment that we previously had, resultant from killing all of those skeletons and those ghosts. Oh. Anyway, okay. Homilies of Vested Alamexria. Yeah. So, we've read this one before. This is a series of homilies, which are little stories that are meant to help you be more moral as a person. And yeah, a lot of what today has been writing my paper. Writing is difficult for me. I've been trying to do the best that I can, and I've made some pretty good progress. We have the skeleton done for it. I have two more days to get about 4 pages, I would say. So 2 pages a day. Not terrible. I did, I think, 2 pages today just in general. It's always frustrating to, like, rewrite, I suppose. Or rather, it's hard not to rephrase everything as you rewrite things. Or as you read something that you've written over and over again. But I'm trying not to succumb to just endlessly rewriting the same few paragraphs. I guess, did I not go down here earlier? No, I did. I explored this area, yeah. There was our friend the corpse here, which seems like he doesn't belong in this area. It seems like he was a grave robber who got this far down and then was killed by the ghosts and skeletons, which, you know, that's definitely something that could happen to us. So we gotta be a little careful. Maybe a staff of summoning. The Shrine of Saint Veloth. Good old faithful tribunal family tomb here. Okay, so this is trapped. I don't think we have a probe anymore. Now, the thing is, we do want security to go up. So, even though we are a... Can I actually hurt the... Uses 18. Okay. So the lockpick cannot be wasted trying to unlock something that you've already unlocked. Oof. Alright. It would be nice to have a telekinesis spell so that I don't have to eat all of these traps to my face. This could be good for selling. We already have potion equipment. Restore personality. We could sell that later. Cheap feather. Not terrible. Ooh, and a bone mold shield. Very interesting. We don't really use shields because we have our spear here. Throwing knife. Ancestors and the Dunmer. So we've read this one already. Basically, this is outlining the family shrine. I think so. Yeah, we've read this before very early on. Talks about the ghost fence here. Mortal chill. Spirits do not like to visit the mortal world, and they do so only out of duty and obligation. Spirits tell us that the other world is more pleasant, or at least less more comfortable for spirits than our real world, which is cold, bitter, and full of pain and loss. Pretty sad. So, the spirits can go mad when you force them to do stuff. Oblivion, which we will see in the next game. The existence of Oblivion is acknowledged by all Tamriel cultures, but there is little agreement in the nature of that other world other than it is a place where the Aedra and Daedra live, and that communication and travel are possible between this world and Oblivion through magic and ritual. The Dunmer do not emphasize the distinction between this world and Oblivion, as do the human cultures of Tamriel. They regard our world and the other world as a whole, with many paths from one end to the other, rather than two separate worlds of different natures with distinct borders. This philosophical viewpoint may account for the greater affinity of elves for magic and its practices. Maybe. It may. Lots of things may happen. This book is written by an unknown scholar as a guide for foreign visitors of Morrowind shortly after the armistice was signed. Many of these practices have since fallen into disfavor. The most obvious change are those regarding the practice of necromancy and the Great Ghost Fence. Dunmer today regard necromancy upon any of the accepted races as an abomination. The Ghost Fence has forced many changes in the praxis of ancestor worship, with the vast majority of ancestors' remains going to strengthen the Great Ghost Fence around the Mountain of Dagoth Ur, where there are very few clan ghost fences in Morrowind. The temple discourages such practices among the houses as selfish. The upkeep of family tombs and private waiting doors has also fallen into disfavor, as very few remains have been buried in these tombs and shrines since the armistice. In recent years, most Dunmer venerate a small portion of their ancestors' remains kept at a local temple. Interesting. So these big family tombs, they're basically gone. All right, well, let's start collecting our library. We have an Ashlander shield, always good. Corpse, and an iron helm we could just pick right up off the corpse. I love when games do that, where they have it physically in the world. Okay, they're there. Oh, hey. Okay. What do we need? We need enchantment stuff. Yeah, I think the only offensive intelligence thing that we have is conjuration. Everything else is willpower, and we don't want to level up willpower with this level up here. Is the ghost even attacking it? Is the skeleton doing anything? We could also check our soul gems here. Could get another ghost. Do that spell trap again. Maybe we could hurry this up. There we go. All right. You got two ancestor ghosts. Yeah, I think we might put this on something. Okay. Not terrible. Definitely an interesting way to use the soul trapping. Oh, wow. That's a guy, isn't it? That's a named person. I wonder what happens if we soul trap them. Well, we don't have a very. Well, I guess if it's a greater soul gem and it's of that level, it might go to the grand one, and I don't want that. But if it's common. Oh no, let's try. We'll do a save. Maybe we'll also do the helm, considering that'll probably save me here. Okay, so we did get the soul. Wooden staff of toxic cloud. Not bad. Go ahead and take that. Craw Blightheart. Right, let's see what we got. It was a grand. Ooh. Okay. Sorry for anyone who wants a pure playthrough, but I'm gonna check this. I don't want to waste a grand soul gem just for nothing. They count as grand soul gems for these named NPCs. And apparently they're good enough to be used for constant and check effect enchanting, which is great. So we have a grand soul gem here. So one of the best uses supposedly is to soul trap them, and we might okay, this is a pretty hard fight in general, so I feel no shame in simply using the cephalopod helm. Got a common and a grand. Not bad. Not bad at all. We got a special staff. Okay. Seems like it's worth a save. Oh wow, a silver katana. Nice. Good old katana. see, that's 6 to 24. Hers is 6 to 26. Okay. Master lockpick. Worth keeping around, certainly. See that Garhide. I think, I don't know if it's Nietzsche leather or Garhide that we're looking out for the Fortify Intelligence. Okay, well, we're gonna see what this raises. It's unarmored, so that's not great for us, but it is a good book, so we're gonna read it for sure. And then I don't know if we can take it without reading it. That's kind of a hard thing about the game, but okay, so the 36 Lessons of Effect, Sermon 15. These were the days of Resedania, so Resedane, when Chimmer and Dwimmer lived under the wise and benevolent rule of the Almsivi. So that's what Morrowind used to be called, Resedane. And their champion, the Hortator, which was Saint Nerevar, so this is our ancestor. When the gods of Veloth would retreat unto their own to mold the cosmos and other matters, the Hortator would at times become confused. Vivek would always be there to advise him, and this is the third of the three lessons of ruling kings. The ruling king will remove me, his maker. This is the way of all children. His greatest enemy is the Sharmat, who is the false dreamer. You or he is the shingle, Hortator. Beware the wrong walking path. Beware the crime of benevolence. Behold him by his words. I am the Sharmat. I am older than music. What I bring is light. What I bring is a star. What I bring is an ancient sea. When you sleep, you see me dancing at the core. It is not a blight. It is my house. I put a star into the world's mouth to murder it. Tear down the pylons, my blind fish. Swim in the new phlogiston. So phlogiston used to be described as a physical principle of what can catch on fire. This is, you know, disproved. I think it's from the late 1700s or early 1800s. It's one of my favorite things to remind people about whenever science gets a little too crazy, is phlogiston is, one of the good examples of the scientific method shaking itself out and disproving itself. And that's always one of the best things about science, is it self-corrects, or it should, ideally. All right. Tear down the pylons, my deaf moons. Sing and burn and orbit me. I am older than music. What I bring is light. What I bring is a star. What I bring is an ancient sea. Okay. So there's this other guy, a Sharmat. And Hortator, I think, is what the Saint Nerevar was called, and I think we need to become Hortator of certain houses. The Telvanni one should be easy, but the other ones might be difficult, because if we're really into Hell's Telvanni, they might hate us a lot. You alone, though you come again and again, can unmake him. Whether I allow it is within my wisdom. Go unarmed into his den with these words of power. Agarthok padome padhom chim a althadun. Or do not. The temporal myth is man. Reach heaven by violence. Achieve heaven through violence. That's a game, I think, right? Or is it? No, Maybe it's an anime. Anyway, it's good. Reach heaven by violence. This magic I give to you. The world you will rule is only an intermittent hope, and you must be the letter written in uncertainty. The ending of the words is Amsibi. All right. It's true. The ending of the words is Amsibi. Oh, that's the skull that we needed. And it's right next to the Dagger of Judgment. Damage to strength and endurance. That's pretty nice. I like it. Nice little dagger there. We'll go ahead and keep it until we find another one or a better one, just as a museum piece. I always like playing these games as collecting little museums. Okay. God Julan Helm. It's an armor rating of 10 and it's medium armor. That could be really good. Not really sure what our current... our current helm armor is for medium armor. We have two sets. Oh, God. Oh, wow, scared me. It's the whispers, man. The whispers just get to you after a while. All right, well, that's the skull. We did it, guys. We killed a necromancer down here. We got their souls. I'm really glad that we thought about soul trapping that big necromancer, because now we can make a constant effect enchantment. I'm not sure, I guess, what constant effect enchantment we would have. I don't know. What do you think would be a good constant effect enchantment if in real life, if you had one? Speed increase? What's up, Bush Kangamoo? Kangamoo. Yeah, it's, we got a soul, but right now our enchanting skill is not high. You know, I definitely don't trust it to be able to, like, try to enchant something really big and have it work out for us. I think we fully explored this area, didn't we? Yeah, we fully explored this area. All right, so that's a fully looted tomb full of undead. And now we just have to walk back to Balmora, deliver that spell. A magic wallet that regens money. Nice. Constant effect enchantment. Magic money. I mean, that would be pretty strong. It just prints money. Or you could gamble it all on the stock market and transform that into money. That's always fun. I wonder if this location does respawn enemies. Because I know the enemies respawn in Morrowind probably to make sure that you can't kill all the monsters in a location and then never be able to level up again. Hey, are we going in circles? Did we? No. Yeah, we're at the end, the exit here. Just gonna do one last loot check. Seems pretty good. Okay, and then we have to walk back to Balmora. Should we walk back to Balmora or should we pay the Silt Strider? How much do we value money versus time? Our carry weight is okay. This is an intelligence level, so we have to make potions. So this could actually help us get stuff from the potions. Yeah. Let's walk it back. Gotta make sure we're going the right way, though, first. Yeah, it's pretty much just north. a relatively well-traveled road for us. I thought there was a special ring down here, if I'm remembering correctly. Oh, that's a Gwar. You actually have the mod where the Silt Strider actually travels in between places. I have not seen that before. That seems cool, though. Where it can, like, move around on the map. You can get it and watch it travel. That's awesome. That would be cool. Yeah, I've been watching Patrician TV and his review of Morrowind and Oblivion, as well as Skyrim. And it's been very convincing. It's been very good. He clearly favors Morrowind, as do I. A lot of it does kind of reflect on the ways that I used to play these games just to get through them, just to play them, and not really to, like, fully appreciate them all the way through. I think I did, like, all the way through the Mage's Guild quest in Oblivion, all the way through the Fighter's Guild quest, and the Dark Brotherhood. I know I did that, and the Thieves Guild. I don't think I ever finished the main quest storyline, though. And that's, like, one of the goals for this playthrough is to actually do the main story as well as the House Telvanni area. Gosh, Morrowind's so cool. Got the bull niches out there. Okay. You ever played around in the construction set? I have not. This is, like, pretty much the first time I've ever really done Morrowind, or, to be honest, a full Let's Play at all, ever in my life. Normally, I play, like, I guess multiplayer games, like The Isle or Hunter Call of the Wild. Those are my two, like, big streaming games that I've done, or just kind of arena multiplayer things like World of Warships, World of Tanks. I did Jedi Rogue Squadron for a while. But yeah, I guess I haven't really, like, considered myself as a creator for a very long time. This whole project I've only been doing for about 2 years. But yeah, many of my friends are video game creators and are computer science people, and they know quite a bit more about that stuff than I do. I guess I could jump into it and really dive in and, like, get my hands dirty with the construction set and stuff. But I just haven't really, I guess that's not all the way where my interest lies with a lot of these games. I'm very interested in, like, history and, like, storytelling and narrative, and I guess the way that the kind of soft skills, or, like, the emotions and the words and, like, the ideas of the world play out. Now, that is a very big telescope. We went to that location. I'm pretty sure we did. And we got inside that telescope place. I'm not sure what it's doing. Is it just an observatory? There might be more to that location than we kind of fully explored. I wonder if other quests will use that area. The urge comes to use it is when you ran out of things to do in this game. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's been out for such a long time that a lot of the people that are still here are, you know, fully invested in the project. It's a wizard's lab. It's related to a quest. Okay. Nice. That makes sense. Good old Moon Moth. Moon Moth Fort right here. It's interesting, like, just how kind of short and condensed the Morrowind map is. I guess it's all representative, you know, kind of like in D&D. Not a bad place for a fort, to be honest. Seems like a strategic location. And also can guard Pelagiad. Okay, so interesting things that we might want to keep. One is the new helm that we got, the God Jul'dan. Ooh, not bad. Sounds like something from Dune. I just watched the Dune movie and it's super, super good. Fully invested in like 18 years ago. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's good. It's worth it. You know, and until we get, like, better Elder Scrolls games in the future, I think that that's what it's gonna have to be. Personally, like, I'm very nervous about which direction the Elder Scrolls is gonna take for Elder Scrolls 6. There is no escape, what? Do I have a bounty? No, I don't. Die, Fetcher. Oh, it's a cliff racer. Oh my God. Oh, Jesus Christ. It's a diseased cliff racer. What? Get out of here. Okay. Hey, that's mean. Go away, wretch. You're not from around here. Something you want to ask about more? Why do they hate me so much? Are they Kamanatong? Or are they Thieves Guild? Why does this person hate me so much? Okay, well, regardless, let's go to visit our new house, which is the Kamanatong location that we've killed everyone in. Always fun. Okay. Let's pick everything up and then drop everything again, just so that we can have it all under one stack, and then we'll go sell. And I think that kind of should do it for today's version of the exciting parts. The rest of it is just going to be me going around and, quite frankly, selling all of the things that I have. Let's see. Let's do this. Let's do... the luck thing, Jack of Trades. I wish I had a spell like that for Jack of Trades. Getting lucky consistently in life would be pretty strong. That would be well worth it. Master Mortars and Pestle. Oh, is that? There we go. All right, the full master set. And I guess we just go ham on this stuff. Go yam. I won't ask any more game questions, but are you in New York? No, I mean, you can. Feel free to ask game questions or out of game questions. It doesn't matter to me. I'm not. I'm in Colorado, originally from California. So I've only West Coast things. I don't think I've ever been to the East Coast, like, ever in my life as an American. So it's kind of like a weird thing, especially for history, where so many history things happen on the East Coast that it's kind of like it helps to go visit Washington, D.C. at least once in your life. What was a restore health? I thought we had a restore health recipe that we were using. I think it's hackle low leaf and something else. Not that restore fatigue is bad. Like, restore fatigue is a perfectly fine potion to make consistently. The moon sugar, should we sell moon sugar? It's not really that expensive, to be honest. Like, you might consider making moon sugar out of something. Certainly some skooma. Yeah, I mean, it's all good. Yeah, I mean, I like the West Coast a lot. I like, you know, kind of lower population density overall, like not in some areas, obviously, like in California. There's, you know, LA and San Francisco. I'm originally from San Diego. I live like outside of Denver, which is a huge city also. So it's a little, in some ways, like being around some major city is always good for having good jobs, and like, you know, the region has many of the good parts of society, but whenever there's too many people in one place, it starts getting really rough. Oh, these potions. Some of these potions seem way harder to make than others. Like 29 hours, restore fatigue. Yeah. Oh, dude, definitely get some sleep. Yeah, my other training is medical. Anyway, I used to work at the hospital, so like, it's very important to get sleep. Your body finds horrible ways to punish yourself in lots of different directions from not sleeping, so I wish you a good night. I found that like temperature is one of the key things to help me sleep. Like if I'm too cold or too hot, it gets really rough. Raw ebony, raw glass. I feel like I shouldn't be using these ingredients on negative potion effects, but also like I just need my skill up, to be honest. Oversleeping recently. Oh yeah, recalibration. I've had to do that too. My sleep schedule has gotten so bad, and I'm starting a new job next week, and I really need to like snap it back into normal. Cause like it had previously turned into me like getting really tired at 6 p.m. and then sleeping till midnight. And that was a weird, weird schedule to be in. And it's also like getting darker a lot earlier because of winter, so. I guess we'll sell the Dre Wax and the Emerald. I mean, they're pretty expensive ingredients, alchemy-wise. Scales. 6 p.m. till 2 a.m. during university. It was awesome. Yeah, I mean, I literally am doing that so I can write my paper. Wake up early, listen to Fleetwood Mac. Amazing. So classic. Ooh. Nice. Interesting that ash salts is a different type of salt. Because we have fire salt. And we have bone meal. Drain personality, okay. Man, some of these ingredients seem pretty hard to use. Scrap metal. I don't really want to use scrap metal that much. Slowed soap. Also very expensive. Maybe I'll keep some of the like super rare ones. Fortify personality potions. Always good. A wickweed. That was the one that I was saving. I think wickweed and salt rice. Or... wickweed and hackalo leaf, I think, was a cure health potion. I might want to buy a book that just has the potions on them. Although that is kind of the fun of alchemy, is like learning them yourself. The film Awakenings. I have not. Is Awakenings, is it a new movie or is it an old movie? Awakenings. I mean, it sounds familiar. I mean, isn't that like a Buddhist thing also? Is Awakenings? Like, there's certain awakenings. Not quite sure. Seems like we're kind of out of potion stuff. Quite old, Robin Williams, De Niro. Okay. I mean, Robin Williams is great. Always appreciate his work. Rest in peace, Robin Williams. Yeah, that suicide actually hit me really hard. Like, Robin Williams was a big hero of mine growing up. Because I grew up doing comedy acting. And I really loved his work. I thought he was like so funny and so smart. And, you know, of course, there's the drugs also in the 80s. But I don't know, he's like a big hero of mine. And like, I don't know, suicide is always hard for everyone. It's always a big issue in society. I felt like I knew he was going to do it. Yeah. I mean, it's a thing about, like, control. I've worked at, you know, an old folks' home, you know, with people at the very end of their life. And it is interesting, like, exactly how it happens. And, like, I wonder if society will eventually create a space where, like, you can die in, like, a controlled way or in a peaceful way. Because, like, some ways of dying are not things that I would want to go through. And I just hope that I have the mental wherewithal and health to advocate for my own actions when I am that old. Yeah, it's one of the existential crisis things that I have. It's like, you know, it makes you want to like get a good job and settle down with a family and get a good enough income stream so that you can have kids so that they can take care of you when you get too old to take care of yourself. And, you know, or just like have the money to pay other people to take care of you, but it's way too expensive. Like, I don't think that anyone could have enough money to fully take care of of themselves in the old age like anymore, I would be very, I'd be shocked if people could. Seven, yeah. We're gonna drop this. We're gonna drop all the stuff that we, all the master's gear. So we had this idea of moving to our location for the Telvanni, but I don't know if we can. Like, it, we, the stuff that we have is so heavy, I don't even know if we could move even if we wanted to. But we're going to definitely start off by selling some of this stuff. The Staff of Toxic Cloud, it weighs 4, so we could keep it with us. The Bone Mold Shield, we'll definitely want to put that with our medium armor. Although I think we have to sell the shields, to be frank. Well, maybe we'll keep the Bone Mold Shield. We don't know when we're going to be using our single player weapon. The dagger, we're going to keep that as a museum. We're going to sell these. Keeping these. Exquisite ring, we're going to keep that. That's hard because the exquisite ring, it is the highest ring slot available for us, and we do have this grand soul gem. I don't know if the money is going to be enough to fully enchant something, you know, like that's going to be hard to tell. At least get some, at least work on getting some money in our pocket. We can sell the rest, I suppose. I don't know, we might want to keep this just for a rainy day, just in case we ever need stuff. You know, these are valuable enough and rare enough that if I sell them and then I end up needing them, I'm gonna kick myself, so I'd rather put them here. So I always know where they are. Ashams, we're saving those. And I think that's it. Pretty sure. Oh yeah, and the books. Homies of Blessed Alamexia are 60. Whoa. Okay. It's a Bloodstained Journal, Dance and Fire. I just want to make sure we don't have any doubles. Oh, it looks like we might. Yep. We have 2 homilies, don't we? Three and 60. Yeah, okay. So let's sell one of these. I knew it. I suspected that we had a double book. So hard to keep track of all the inventory in this game, but you know, that's the game. It's weird that the cephalopod helm looks like an ash yam. Make powerful feather potions? Sure, yeah. I mean, that would definitely help us selling stuff. Extravagant, extragative, expensive. I'm gonna sell expensive. Yeah, we want exquisite, but that's our cutoff, is at least extravagant. That's what we're aiming for. Go see our good friend Ravir. It's too late. Okay. Well, actually, we can go turn in our quest at least. Unless she gives us something. Maybe we should save, actually. Saving might be good. Hello. I'm Hal Stelvani, but don't worry about that. Nothing in the chest. All right, so Okay, so we had this stuff. Necromancy. I'm not a necromancer. No, absolutely not. Huh. So this was a journeyman enchanter. I wonder if she's being honest with us. Very good. I'll just take that skull from you. Perfect for what I have in mind. Thank you. Now, as I promised, I'll answer your questions on the Nervarine cult. Go ahead. Okay. So this Ashlander cult believes the long-dead hero Nerevar, that's us, will be reborn to honor ancient promises to the tribes. According to legend, the prophesied Nerevarine, oh, thanks Prince Magnus, appreciate it, will cast down the false gods of the tribunal temple, restore the traditional ancestor worship practiced by the Ashlanders, and drive all Outlanders from Morrowind. Wow, that's a tall order. Good luck with that, getting the Imperials out of here. Both temple and empire outlaw the cult, but it persists among the Ashlanders, who care little for Imperial or Temple law. Yeah, they have their own law. It's called Ashlander law. Here, take this copy of my notes on the topic for Caius. Okay, not bad. You have any other stuff? I'm quite satisfied. Okay, not bad. Okay. Let's see, what does she have? Cure poison, that's okay. A strong cure health, these seem all right. Kind of surprised I haven't picked these up yet. Yeah, might be good. Okay, well, I think that's the quest for Curio. Maybe we should read these notes. Following our notes from Sharon Gra Muzgob to Caius Kosades. Nerevarine cult. This Ashlander religious cult follows prophecies of a Nerevar reborn to honor the ancient promises. To honor ancient promises to the tribes, to reestablish the traditions of the prophet Veloth, to cast down the false gods of the tribunal temple, and to drive all the false gods. Okay, wow. So they are just openly telling them that the tribunal gods are false. And drive all Outlanders from Morrowind. Both temple and empire outlaw the cult. Because it is persecuted, it remains a secret cult, and it is hard to judge how widespread it is among the Ashlanders, or whether it has any following outside the Ashlander tribes. The Ashlanders firmly believe that the Nerevar will return to restore the glories of ancient Rhes Dane. Morrowind was called Rhes Dane before the Imperial occupation. The Ashlanders say the great houses and the temple have abandoned the pure teachings of the prophet Veloth. Okay, so we have some religious schism going on. Forsaking ancestor worship for the false gods of the tribunal and embracing the comforts of civilization that corrupted the High Elves. Yeah, the High Elves are pretty corrupt, so you can easily see it. For 6k hours in it between PC and original Xbox, so I had many mods installed. Yeah, Belmore expansion was one. I think I have Morrowind Rebirth. I'm not sure what Belmore expansion does differently than Morrowind Rebirth. But, yeah, my primary experience with it was on Xbox way back in the day, but I've forgotten pretty much everything about the game, and this is my first playthrough coming back to it on PC, my first time playing it on PC, and, yeah, so I guess I'm taking the Rebirth version of it as the normal version. The temple, on the other hand, venerates Saint Nerevar, but rejects the disgusting notion that the false incarnate will walk the earth like a ghoul. Okay. Like a ghoul. I guess being raised from the dead and reincarnated? Are we the false incarnate? Or is there a different false incarnate? Or is the false incarnate what we'll become if we don't do the prophecy correctly? I feel like Jesus having to go through all the different prophecies and enacting them in order. Back then, Reverse was small. Expansion added a lot more shops, modded weapons, more houses, even added a bathhouse. Ooh, nice. Nerevar. The temple honors Saint Nerevar as the greatest Dunmer general, first counselor, and companion of Vivek. I think Vivek was our companion, actually. Alamexri and Sothisil, who united the Dunmer houses to destroy the evil Dwemer, the treacherous House Dagoth, and their western allies at the Red Mountain. But the Ashlanders say Nerevar promised to honor the ancient spirits and the tribal law, and that he will come again to honor that promise. Okay, so this is like a periphery group of the Ashlanders that have always been more traditionalist. And even when Saint Nerevar was alive, Saint Nerevar went to them and appealed to them in ways that no one else had. So the Ashlanders have been here a very long time, and they've always been complaining about society. And, you know, for lack of a better term, they're very politically conservative in the sense that they want to do the old ways. They want to do the old things, like ancestor worship still, and not worship the tribunal gods. To the Ashlanders, this means destroying the false temple and driving the imperial invaders from the land. Okay. The Nerevarine prophecies. Dream visions and prophecies are a respected tradition in Ashlander culture. Their wise women and shamans take careful note of dreams and visions and pass on the tribe's legacies of vision and prophecy to their successor. By contrast, the temple and the Western faiths are suspicious of mysticism, and they regard interpretation of dreams and visions as primitive superstition. Sound familiar? The most common version of the Nerevarine prophecy is the Stranger. Ooh, the Stranger. That sounds like us. And the verses are obscure, as are most of the prophecies, but two observations are in order. First, many less well-informed scholars assume that the phrase journeyed far neath moon and star is just a cliche to suggest a very long journey, but the Nerevar of legend was known to possess a magical ring named One Clan under Moon and Star, upon which Nerevar is supposed to have sworn his promise to honor an ancient Ashlander traditions, and land rights. Second, the reference to seven curses must certainly refer to the lost prophetic verses known to the Ashlanders as the Seven Curses. The Stranger. When earth is sundered and skies choked black, and sleepers serve the seven curses, to the hearth there comes a stranger, journeyed far neath moon and star. Though stark born to sire uncertain, his aspect marks his certain fate. Wicked stalk him, righteous curse him. Interesting. Is that the Dark Brotherhood? And the righteous curse him? Maybe the temple curses us? Prophets speak, but all deny. Many trials make manifest the stranger's fate, the curse's bane. Many touchstones try the stranger. Many fall, but one remains. Okay, so are there multiple people trying out for this prophecy, and only you get it if you survive all the different things? The Lost Prophecies. Ashlander elders complain of prophecies which have been lost to tribal memory due to the carelessness or ineptitude of earlier generations of wise women and Ashcans. Okay. So they're criticizing their own culture also, which is very interesting. They seem to just not like anyone. They don't like each other. They don't like society. They're just grumpy. Yeah. Ashlander elders complain of prophecies which have been lost to tribal memory due to the carelessness of ineptitude of earlier generations of wise women and Ashcans. Yeah, same. I'm also pissed off at my earlier generations of Ashcans. Suspicious scholars wonder whether these prophecies might have been deliberately forgotten or suppressed. Yeah, three Neverine. I'm actually doing work on cultural memory suppression with the Civil War in America right now. That's what my paper is on, for the suppression of African-American officers in the Union Army, which conflicts with Lost Cause Southern narratives and robs the North from their like white savior complex idea. All right, three Nerevarine prophecies in particular are said to have been lost. One, the Lost Prophecies, of course. Two, the Seven Curses, and three, the Seven Visions of Seven Trials of the Incarnate. Perhaps these Lost Prophecies will someday be found, either in forgotten accounts written by literate travelers, or in the memories of isolated Ashlanders, or in the secret traditions of the wise women and shamans. So here we see this like oral tradition that is struggling to be preserved with the normal society, which pretty much exclusively works off of written tradition, which is a huge, I guess, new frontier in history, so much so that many historians don't even consider oral traditions to be actual history in the first place, because it's not written down, and it changes partly with every retelling, or with the audience, or with the teller. Anyone who's ever told a story knows that the story can change based on who's listening to it and what you remember and choose to emphasize. So I really like telling like comedic stories from my past. If you stick around the channel, I'm sure you'll hear a few of them. A lot of shit has happened to me. It's pretty funny. But you know, like that's one of the first very human ways of passing down information. Certainly this seems to be based on Native American traditions, or at least like Mongolian traditions. Maybe some Inuit that we have in here. But yeah, it's great. This is why we love this game, is there's genuine cultural differences that are causing conflict, at least to the Imperial Blade spy, Caius Cosades, who's attempting to get all this information as an outlander, as an outsider who shouldn't have that information in the first place. But he's, you know, he's a curious noble. He's a spy. That's his job. All right, we'll take it across the river and hand it to him. I don't see any harm in doing that. All right, and that is... After that, we should probably quit, though. Oh, geez. Landis Baelal. I am a sleeper, one of the among thousands. I bring you a message. Dagoth Ur calls you, Tabiri, and you cannot deny your lord. The sixth house is risen, and Dagoth is its glory. Okay. Hi. Yeah, no thank you. I don't want to convert to your church. Dagoth Ur, he is the lord and father of the mountain. He sleeps, but when he wakes, we shall rise from our dreams. We shall sweep our land clean of the Enwa. Wow. Why have you denied him? As Lord Dagoth has said, all shall greet him as flesh or as dust. Okay. The sixth house, the sleeping house, House Dagoth, the house of Lord Dagoth, the true house, the one house to welcome all true Dunmer. No true Scotsman would ever succumb to the true Scotsman fallacy. He's a true Dunmer. And drive the Enwa from our land. Rejoice and join us. Come to Red Mountain and prepare the way for his coming. Okay. I mean, I wonder if we can do that. I wonder if we can just, like, go straight to Dagoth Ur and just hang out with him. I mean, there's a lot of, that's a bit of an intimidating thing. Hello. Okay. Yeah, a little creepy that we have these six house sleepers just hanging around. Oh, what do I have? Brown rot and hell joint. I have two different diseases. I wonder if one cure disease will actually solve both of them. Gosh, that's so crazy. What do you got? Cure common disease? I'm sure it's common disease. Oh, yep. One is good for all of them. That's what we need in the COVID times. All right. Maybe that's why that Argonian hated us so much, is maybe we got diseased from that cliff racer. Or is there something else? And these are Sharn's notes on the Neverine cult. Excellent. I'm promoting you to Blade's Apprentice, Tiberi. I'd like some time to think about how this fits in with the Emperor's plans for you. I love that this game does that. It gives you time in between the main quest objectives for you to do whatever you were going to do normally, like in the story. And that's great. And it also is very realistic. I wish you'd kind of put on a shirt. It just seems to be like hanging out in this room, like smoking skooma all day. Seems like a good life. Being a spy in a foreign exotic land, getting addicted to opium, reading, you know, academic journal mysticism stuff, getting involved with politics. I want to grow up and be Caius Cosades, actually. He seems like he has a cool lifestyle. He's all unarmed and unarmored and speechcraft. Sounds like a cool guy. Just works out, does MMA. Just like does, you know, Krav Maga and Judo, Jiu-Jitsu, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu at home. If you'd like to get in a little freelance adventuring, go ahead. But whenever you're ready, I'll have new orders for you. Okay. That's fair. All right, I think that's how we're going to end it for today. Thank you guys so much for dropping by. Yeah, we probably need a cure blight disease to cure COVID. Absolutely. I think cure blight is a little upgraded from cure common disease there. I mean, I wonder if it's corpus. Oof. That's like the zombie disease for sure. That's like the Zeta. All right. I will see you guys later. Thank you guys so much for dropping by. Always appreciate you hanging out and chatting. Thank you very much. Peace.